following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
She's got the news. She talks with newsmakers. She encourages us to laugh, and she cries with us. Speaking truth to power and questioning authority daily, it's the Nicole Sandler Show.
All right, welcome to it. Nicole Sandler here at NicoleSandler.com. Oh, it would help if I changed the picture. At the Progressive Voices Network, streaming video on Periscope, on Twitch, on Facebook Live, still sadly suspended from YouTube. Working on it from this end, although I don't hold out any hope that we'll be able to fix it. The good news is my suspension is up October 14th. So if YouTube is true to their word, we'll be back streaming video again. We'll see. We'll see. In the meantime, Twitch is awesome. Periscope is better. Facebook, is Facebook, but it's there. I need to begin today with a correction, because I hate it when I get things wrong. But you know what? I'm human and I get things wrong occasionally, fairly often, in fact. But I was wrong yesterday, and thanks to those of you who alerted me, it was actually Neil Gorsuch who filled Antonin Scalia's seat. That is the Supreme Court seat that was kept open for almost a year by the Republican-run Senate to deny Obama a nomination that was rightfully his. So Brett Kavanaugh was the second nomination made by Donald Trump. He filled the seat vacated by the retiring Anthony Kennedy, who I still think was retired under duress. There's something there that has not been thoroughly investigated yet, and I hope some intrepid journalist out there looks into it, because you know there was a deal made with Kennedy and the Trump clan for him to leave so Trump could fill that seat. Anyway, I was confused because of Lindsey Graham's bullshit statement that everything for me changed with Kavanaugh, right? To refresh your memory, back in 2016, Lindsey Graham, wait a second, was this 2016? No, this was 2018. I'm sorry. So in 2018, Lindsey Graham was interviewed by Jeffrey Goldberg of The Atlantic. Yeah, him, same guy. At the Atlantic conference, it was on video. It's all there. And here's what Lindsey Graham said. I'm going to play you the longer version right now. It's like 2 minutes, but I want you to hear the context in which he said it. Oh, it would help if I turned that up. Here we go.
This is the last year of a lame duck president. And if Ted Cruz or Donald Trump get to be president, they've all asked us not to confirm or take up a selection by President Obama. So if a vacancy occurs in their last year of their first term, guess what? Use their words against them. I want you to use my words against me. If there's a Republican president in 2016 and a vacancy occurs in the last year of the first term, you can say, Lindsey Graham said, let's let the next president, whoever it might be, make that nomination, and you could use my words against me, and you'd be absolutely right. We're setting a precedent here today, Republicans are, that in the last year, at least of a lame duck 8-year term, I would say it's going to be a 4-year term, that you're not going to fill a vacancy of the Supreme Court based on what we're doing here today. That's going to be the new rule. When y'all change the rules about appellate judges and district court judges to get your way, I thought it was a really abuse of power. And what you have done here is you've made the caucuses, the Republican and Democratic caucuses, are now not going to have to reach across the aisle when it comes to appellate judges and district court judges.
This is all true.
To get input from us, or we get input from you. So what does that mean? That we're going to pick the most hard-ass people we can find. And dare somebody in the conference to vote against that person.
Yeah.
You're going to have the most liberal members of your caucus pushing you to pick the most liberal judges, because you don't need to have to reach across the aisle to get any of our input. And we'll do the same. So over time, the judiciary is going to be more ideologically driven, because the process in the Senate now does not require you to get outside your own party. So I'll be fighting talk radio when somebody on my side puts up a nut job, and they will.
Okay. So
I'll fight if I think they're truly a nut job. That's going to happen on your side too.
Okay. So that, you know, I'm confused because I thought that was the Atlanta conference audio, but it wasn't because we didn't hear Jeffrey Goldberg in there. Is this the same? Pardon me, but let me see if this is from the same segment.
I want you to use my words against me. If there's a Republican president in 2016 and a vacancy occurs in the last year of the first term, you can say Lindsey Graham said, let's let the next president, whoever it might be, make that nomination. And you could use my words against me and you'd be absolutely right. We're setting a precedent here today, Republicans are, that in the last year, at least of a lame duck 8-year term,
so
I would say it's going to be a 4-year term.
4-year term.
That you're not going to fill a vacancy of the Supreme Court based on what we're doing here today.
Okay,
so that's going to be the new rule.
I've screwed up again, and I hate when I do that, but I'll be the first to admit that I do it fairly often. There is other video of Lindsey Graham talking with Jeffrey Goldberg from 2018 that I thought that's what it was, but this says 2016. Regardless, the Atlanta conference at which Lindsey Graham said, hold me to this. There's tape. And Jeffrey Goldberg said, there's tape. And Lindsey said, hold on to it. How did I not, what did I do? I'm going to find it. If it kills me, I'm going to find it. But that happened on October 8th, 2018. Obviously not the audio I played there because this was before the Neil Gorsuch confirmation. But he did it again. He said it on October 8th, 2018, that he agreed with that, which was 2 months or a month after the Kavanaugh confirmation hearings. Here's what he said on Fox just the other day.
I've seen this movie before. It's not going to work. It didn't work with Kavanaugh. We've got the votes to confirm Justice Ginsburg replacement before the election. We're going to move forward in the committee. We're going to report the nomination out of the committee to the floor of the United States Senate so we can vote before the election. That's the constitutional process. After Kavanaugh, everything changed with me. They're not going to intimidate me, Mitch McConnell, or anybody else. I'm getting outraised 3-1, outspent 4-1.
Oh,
if you
this
want to
is
help
the,
me
the,
fight
the
back,
woe is me part.
Go to LindseyGraham.com.
Ooh.
$5 or $10 from half your audience.
Lindsey's hurting.
I'm facing.
Go, Jamie Harrison.
But we're going to have a process that you'll be proud of. The nominee is going to be supported by every Republican in the Judiciary Committee, and we've got the votes to confirm the judge, the justice on the floor of the Senate before the election, and that's what's coming.
Okay, so that's when he said everything for me changed with the Kavanaugh hearings, right? Well, no. Okay, this is, I'm playing it off the video. You're not seeing the video. I didn't sleep last night. Not that I'm making excuses, but I guess I am. All right, so this is Lindsey Graham talking to Jeffrey Goldberg at the Atlanta conference. The date was October 8th, 2018. The Kavanaugh confirmation hearing took place September 4th through the 7th, so a month earlier.
Scalia dies in 2016. The primary process is ongoing.
He's recounting
now
what happened.
If you look back in 100 years, nobody has been replaced under that circumstance.
Okay.
If you listen to what Joe Biden said in Bush 41, you should hold it over to the next election.
Mm-hmm.
Joe is right a lot.
Oh.
So I felt like I was doing the traditional thing there. When it came to Sotomayor and Kagan, I thought I did the traditional thing. Now I'll tell you this.
Yeah?
This may make you feel better, but I really don't care. If an opening comes in the last year of President Trump's term.
Yeah.
And the primary process has started.
Yeah.
We'll wait to the next election.
Really?
And I've got a pretty good chance of being the judiciary.
You're on the record.
You're on the record.
All right.
Hold the tape.
Hold the tape.
Judge.
Okay, so you heard that. That was, again, October 8th, 2018. So his bullshit that he said the other day, this weekend on Fox News Sunday,
com, $5 or $10.
Now, this is after he cries, I'm getting beaten up in South Carolina.
But we're going to have a process that you'll be proud of. The nominee is going to be supported by every Republican in the Judiciary Committee, and we've got the votes to confirm the judge,
I must have passed
the justice
it.
On the floor of the Senate.
I'm having one of those days.
They're not going to intimidate me, Mitch McConnell, or anybody else.
Yeah.
I'm getting outraged 3-1,
nope,
outspent 4-1 on the floor of the United States Senate, so we can vote before the election. That's the constitutional process. After Kavanaugh, everything changed with me.
After Kavanaugh, everything changed with me? Well, that's a lie. The technical term for that is...
bullshit.
Because Lindsey Graham, you heard it from his own mouth, said it at the Atlanta conference a month after the Kavanaugh hearing. Keep the tape. So he's just full of shit. So I was wrong. It was Gorsuch confirmed first, then Kavanaugh, who filled the seat vacated by Anthony Kennedy, which I think he was coerced into vacating early, if you want to know the truth, but I can't prove it. Oh, my goodness. You know, I came to the conclusion. I was wondering what it was about the year 2020, where everything that could go wrong goes wrong. I figured it out. 2020 is the Murphy's Law of years. It's Murphy's year. It's just, it's not 2020 anymore. It's Murphy. Today is September 22nd, the year of the Murph. Because we're fucked. Because anything that can go wrong will go wrong. I mean, really, Ruth Bader Ginsburg, 45 some odd days before the election. I mean, if she had held on another month, we wouldn't even be having this conversation. I know she probably held on as long as she could, and I hate that she had pancreatic cancer and we didn't know. I mean, we knew, but we didn't know. She was fighting four different kinds of cancers, and I'm sorry I'm rambling again. It's because this is what my mind is doing, and I know I'm not alone. Because when I was awake at 4 o'clock this morning, I saw some of you on Twitter. I know I'm not alone, and it's scary as shit. And just when you think there's all these things that the Senate can do, we realize, no, actually, there's absolutely nothing we can do. And when GottaLaff is here, it's not very laughable, but we'll fill you in on all of that. Speaking of laughs, I don't know about you, but I could use some. So with that in mind, I think I got my echo problem from yesterday fixed, I hope. Fingers crossed. Uh-oh. All right, somebody's calling. Let's see who it is. Hi, who is this calling from the 205 area code?
Hi, this is Proud Scal from Alabama.
From Alabama, how you doing?
I'm doing fine. The other day, I ran into, I think, what was a stealth QAnon group in front of my federal courthouse.
Okay, what were they doing?
They were saying that there was a lot of human trafficking, and in closer examination of their displays and handouts and posters, they also talk about being pro-life. And it led me to believe that this is a QAnon group.
Yeah, they probably was. And they are growing because they've gotten the seal of approval from the President of the United States. As ridiculous as this sounds, any normal president would have disavowed them immediately. Right out, those people are nuts. These are the people who are behind the whole, you know, Pizzagate, a child trafficking ring out from the basement of the pizza place. It's insane.
Oh, tell me about it. I went to the site of Pizzagate, and right next door to that is Politics and Prose Bookstore, which is the largest independent bookstore in D.C. So you know that Pizzagate couldn't have happened. I mean, just from seeing that on the street.
Of course, it's asinine. But so is Donald Trump. So are these idiots that are embracing those people. We've got a number of them. I think there's two or three who actually won their Republican primaries and stand a good chance, in some cases, of going to Congress.
Oh, yes, yeah, some idiot from Rome, Georgia,
yep.
I believe.
Yeah, yeah.
And so. Also, I'd like to talk about the nomination for Supreme Court for Ginsburg's seat.
Yeah.
I think a good strategy for us to do this is, I know this is going to hurt a lot of people, but losing that Supreme Court seat and filling it with a fascist is going to hurt us dearly.
Yeah.
So I think a strategy would be trying to convince Pelosi to have a government shutdown before the election.
No, a shutdown is not the way to go, because that would fall at the feet of the Democrats. Although I do think they should block every single thing the Republicans try to do. What they need to do is another impeachment. Either impeach Donald Trump again, God knows there's a whole plethora of menu items to choose from, or impeach Bill Barr, because he has the most horrific, sorry excuse for an attorney general this nation has ever seen.
I definitely agree with that, and I've also heard there is an effort, or has been an effort, by DAs in the country and former DAs to try to find a way to disbar him from either the Maryland or Virginia bar.
He's got to be disbarred entirely. I mean, I don't think we've ever had as crooked an attorney general, and it's sickening watching this man. Proud Skull, I'm going to run on because I got Laffy standing by and I got some stuff to take care of before we get to Laffy. So thank you for calling. It's good to hear from you. Hope you're staying safe in Alabama. Oop. Oh, I guess he is. Sorry. That was abrupt, but thank you for calling. Always good to hear from you. And the first half hour of the show, the phone lines are always open. All right, what I was about to say is I could use a bit of levity at the moment. So Lauren Mayer heard Donald Trump's interview the other day, or it was last week now, with George Stephanopoulos, where Trump couldn't quite come up with the term herd immunity, because, you know, the Adderall fries the brain. Instead, he said herd mentality, which is something different, and actually it's something that his followers suffer from. Either way, our friend Lauren Mayer took it and ran with it and gave us a new song. Take it away, Lauren Mayer.
When COVID-19 spread, Trump just played golf instead, because with science he did disagree. He knows what cures the virus, herd mentality. The tapes have proved he lied all those times he denied the crisis he said would end magically. He thought he'd pull it off with herd mentality. Why are red state folks scared of simple tasks, social distancing and wearing masks? 'Cause they listen to lies that pour on from that moron. And think of all the books about those White House crooks, what keeps them back in Trump's idiocy. They've all got well-developed herd mentality. Trump keeps mocking Biden's intelligence while he proves his own incompetence, pushing conspiracies in such a coy way. This thing he wants to try means millions more will die. Well, math was never a Trump specialty, or English or science or facts, and so he's advocating herd mentality. Meanwhile, his fans are illustrating herd mentality. So let's vote to start obliterating this absurd herd mentality. When COVID-19 spread, Trump just played golf instead.
These are the sounds of crushed souls. The sounds of despair from former radio personalities languishing in the purgatory of corporate consolidation. These former radio personalities have lost their livelihoods, not because they weren't entertaining or informative, but because they don't meet today's corporate terrestrial broadcast standards of being smelly, overweight douchebags, seething with vein-popping hatred. These radio refugees and their audiences have since migrated to the internet, but their struggle continues as the quest for monetization ensues. Nicole Sandler is leading the way to re-establishing thought-provoking and entertaining radio. And you can help by clicking the donate button on NicoleSandler.com. Donate today, or as much and as often as you can. Dry the tears of listeners by removing the rotting stench of corporate radio. Won't you help?
This is the last year of a lame duck president. And if Ted Cruz or Donald Trump get to be president, they've all asked us not to confirm or take up a selection by President Obama. So if a vacancy occurs in their last year of their first term, guess what? You will use their words against them. I want you to use my words against me. If there's a Republican president in 2016 and a vacancy occurs in the last year of the first term, you can say, Lindsey Graham said, let's let the next president, whoever it might be, make that nomination, and you could use my words against me, and you'd be absolutely right.
Just seems that the economy does better under the Democrats than the Republicans. Just seems that the economy does better under the Democrats than the Republicans. Just seems that the economy does better under the Democrats than the Republicans. Just seems that the economy does better under the Democrats than the Republicans. Just seems that the economy does better under the Democrats than the Republicans.
On the Progressive Voices Network and NicoleSandler.com.
Oh, yes. Best laid plans and all that stuff. I know what time it is, don't you? I'm having some hell of a day, I gotta tell you. It's Murphy's Law and Murphy's Year and Murphy's Day, and here we go.
If the news gives you the blues, here's the perfect place to go.
Hi.
It's Tuesdays with GottaLaff on the Nicole Sandler Show.
Every day when my brain is functioning a little better, we get together with our pal GottaLaff to shoot the shit about what's going on in the news. First, we got to get her on the line. Hello.
Hi.
Hi.
We're not doing press one today, guys.
We're not.
Sorry. Too depressing. I mean, it's not depressing. Everything else is too depressing.
Oh, my God. I'm so discombobulated, but you had a sleepless night last night as well, huh?
I've had sleepless nights for three nights in a row. So, I'm out of it. I sat down to try to write jokes, and I could not be funny. I could not even begin to think about a topic.
Yeah.
I'm thinking, it's how I usually start. What do I write about? What are the big headlines this week? Oh, Ruth Bader Ginsburg died. Yeah. Okay, what's another headline? Supreme Court Justice. Okay, what's another headline?
Yeah.
And I couldn't come up with one. So I instead came up with three Ruth Bader Ginsburg quotes.
Oh, good.
To honor her.
Okay.
That's and to cover nice. For my lack of joke writing.
It's okay. Hey, I get it. Believe me. I played the Lauren Mayer video because we needed some comedy, but the last thing I'm doing is laughing right now.
Yeah, I don't think I've ever been as scared to my core for so long as I am now. I mean, I've had personal, health issues of my kids or I don't know what, things that, had a car accident or whatever. Things that really get to you. But it's been 4 years of this, and the last few months have been brutal.
It's like just on brutal. Steroids. It's in warp, I hate to use the term, warp speed, but it's like, he's coming more and more unhinged every day, and that's like thinking that he started from a place of being hinged in the first place, which he never was. So
right, this he's unhinged.
Exactly. It's
he's beyond unhinged.
Yeah,
he's dehinged.
All right. So give us some of those Ruth quotes. Maybe it'll inspire us.
Okay. Well, the first one was, when I'm sometimes asked, when will there be enough women on the Supreme Court? My answer is, when there are nine. People are shocked. Yep, people are shocked. But there's been nine men, and nobody's raised a question about that.
Nope. I hear you. Okay.
Right?
Yep, one.
Okay. Yay.
Yay.
So press one if you like that. Yay.
Did.
Okay, press two if you like this one, because you're going to make press it. The enormous difference between fighting gender discrimination as opposed to race discrimination is good people immediately perceive race discrimination as evil and intolerable. But when I talked about sex-based discrimination, I get the response, what are you talking about? Women are treated ever so much better than men.
By who?
I don't know. Somebody held the door open for me once.
Yeah,
so, yay.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
And the final one is a short one. I ask no favors for my sex. All I ask of our brethren is that they take their feet off our necks.
Fuck yeah. Yeah.
And there are the quotes.
She said that recently. Let me give you one more.
Okay.
Here's Ruth. The best advice her mother ever gave her.
The best advice I've ever received, and it came from my mother-in-law.
A mother-in-law.
The day we were married in Marty's home. And just before the ceremony, mother said, Ruth, I would like to tell you the secret of a happy marriage.
Okay.
Oh, I'd be delighted to know. What is it? It helps every now and then to be a little deaf.
Deaf. A little deaf, she said.
So if an unkind or thoughtless word is spoken, you just tune out. You don't hear it.
Mm.
Now that is advice I have followed not only in a marriage for 56 years, but also to this day in dealing with my colleagues.
How much do we love her? I just was heartbroken, you know, on a personal level. She felt like my grandmother. I've never met the woman, never met her, but just loved her, loved everything about her. The film RBG, I did that the whole time I interviewed the filmmakers. Before CNN had it, it was a theatrical release, and CNN bought it, and now it's a CNN film, which they aired the other night. But it's such a wonderful look at her.
So good, yeah.
And I just, you know, I already respected her. I had great, tremendous respect. I was in awe of her. But then I just fell in love with her. It's like a booby. Like a grandmother, right? And so I feel that loss. I mean, I haven't had a grandparent in many, many years. So I don't know. It just, a part of our history is gone. One of the best parts of our history. And that's what makes it so sad, because you look at what's left and it sucks.
It's horrible. It's, you know, you talk about a vacuum. This is like a chasm. This is like the Grand Canyon times 20. Because nothing can fill it except hatred right now. Everybody, you know, his Supreme Court picks are going to be bigoted,
terrible.
Who knows what? Awful.
Oh my God! You look at the people that he's considering now, and so far we have two names: Amy Coney Barrow, whatever her name is. She is from this. She's part of this religious sect. I'm sorry.
Right.
I guess some people say she's Catholic. She's way out there, and I didn't pull it. The name of the group she belongs to is what Margaret Atwood used as her inspiration for The Handmaid's Tale. That's how whacked out these fucking people are. They want to turn us into a theocracy. This is Sharia law, make no mistake. Religious dogma in government is Sharia law. Call it Christian Sharia law if you want. I don't care. I don't see the difference. And this is what they want to put in there. Donald Trump is not a religious man.
Oh,
he's as much
know.
Of an atheist as I am. And yet he is such a con man, such a bullshitter, that he's got evangelicals believing his crap. I'm sorry. This, we have seen the dumbest part of America. I know it's not smart to call Trump voters stupid, but my God, these people are fucking stupid. Have you seen them at his rallies?
Yes. It's ridiculous. Today they were showing this long line waiting to get in, and they weren't wearing masks, and they required that they take their temperature, so this person's going up to each one, and this line is like endless. And I said, what is the point of that? First of all, if you're asymptomatic, you're
not going to have a fever.
Go ahead.
Right.
And then that person who's asymptomatic is surrounded by a bunch of other people. So pretty soon, none of them will be well, or some of them will feel well, but they won't be well. They're spreading it all over in the line.
Yes,
and taking exactly. their temperature doesn't gonna right. isn't gonna do a thing.
Not
you
at
have
all.
To do more than only take their temperature.
Yeah,
that's why when doctors' offices take my temperature, that's fine, but that's not enough.
No, of course not. I mean, that's ridiculous. One of the screening tools, but it's one of. And again, they've learned there's asymptomatic spread. People who don't know they're carriers, don't know they have the virus, are going out and infecting other people. That's why you get tested. Taking their temperature isn't going to tell them anything because they're asymptomatic. They don't have a fever.
Right. Ugh. It's like when those people go to the market and you say, oh, look, everybody's wearing masks. But those people may not have washed their hands. Those people may not even be wearing their masks properly. They're running around the store, and people don't realize that they could possibly get infected just by, you know, everything looks okay. Everything looks clean. Everything looks separated. But that's how it's spread. It seems so innocent, but it's not.
And then, here's the height of idiocy. So we remember, first of all, over the weekend, the Centers for Disease Control put a new warning up on the website, right? It said that, you know, the warning, this followed, the CDC has lost all credibility. CDC about a week or two ago put up a thing saying, if you're asymptomatic, even if you've been exposed to someone, if you're asymptomatic, you don't have to get tested. The medical community went, what the fuck? Yes, you do. And finally, the CDC backtracked and changed it and said, we were mistaken. If you've been exposed, whether you're symptomatic or not, you need to get tested. Thank you. Then this weekend, they put out a thing that said, wow, that
aerosol is now the number one way to get it. That's
exactly.
What they were
that the particles are airborne and that's how it's being spread.
But and that's how their focus became that.
Right.
Instead of touch mode, it's breathe mode. And everyone said, oh, we all knew that. No, what they did was they changed the emphasis. This is the most likely way you will get it, as opposed to this is one way you'll get it.
Right.
So that's where the emphasis changed. And then they took that off.
Yes. Then they took that off. And then, they took that off. And now they're saying, well, we didn't mean that was just a draft. It wasn't supposed to be released. We still say the prime method of infection is from surfaces or some person to person. Excuse me. We go back to, shit. I thought I pulled it. Where Trump told, what's his face? Bob Woodward. It spread through the air. It spread
back
through
in January, February, whatever it was. Yeah.
Yeah. I thought I pulled that instead I pulled
like today,
this one.
Just like when he said at the rally, nobody's going to get
here,
it.
This is what he said.
Kids are immune.
This
again.
Is what he said at the rally.
Okay.
We now know the disease. We didn't know it. Now we know it. It affects elderly people with heart problems and other problems. If they have other problems, that's what it really affects. That's it. You know, in some states, thousands of people, nobody young, below the age of 18, like nobody.
Lie.
They have a strong immune system. Who knows?
You what? Know, you
take your hat off to the young, because they have a hell of an immune system. But it affects virtually nobody.
It's virtually nobody.
Thing. By the way, open your schools. Everybody open
what?
Your schools.
Oh, my God. No, and all you have to do is go back to February 7th. February 7th.
It goes through air, Bob. That's always tougher than the touch. You know, the touch, you don't have to touch things, right? But the air, you just breathe the air. That's how it's passed.
This is what I call opposite
Even
world.
With young kids, he said.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God.
I don't think it was the same tape, but it was on tape.
Yeah.
Found out that kids can get it.
Of course kids can get it. And they can spread it. Oh,
nobody's immune.
God. Can we, we got a little song for Donald Trump.
Yeah.
And it's not the fuck you song. Yeah. Instead, you talk too much.
I just need you to shut the fuck up, cause nobody asked you, bitch. I need you to shut the fuck up, bitch. 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 Bow, bow, shut the fuck up. Shut the fuck up. Bow, bow, shut the fuck up. Shut the fuck up.
Bow, bow.
Shut the fuck up. Shut the fuck up. Shut the fuck up.
Bow, bow. Oh, hello? Hello. We have somebody calling in. I think I know who this is. Hi, who's this? I'm sorry, who? Hello? You still there? I think this is our... What? This is one of those days. This is one of those... I said it's Murphy's year. It's the year of the Murph. It's Murphy's law day, too. Our 619 caller, a kid from... Oh, I see what I did. I think I muted you. Hold on 1 second, because I didn't want him to talk. Are you there, sir?
This is Vivian Marlborough from the other day.
Look, right, so you're the kid.
I'm getting kind of angry.
Okay, so listen. Just to so people know who this is a young man who called in, lives in San Diego with his mother, who's a wonderful woman, left me a lovely message, but he is you're not a Trumper, but you're a right winger. You're 18 years old,
yes, ma'am.
You haven't lived life.
I'm also Muslim.
Okay.
And if you want to keep putting more things out about me, I'm also Muslim, and I'm potentially bisexual as well.
Good for you.
Why would that be a bad thing?
And what does that have to do with anything?
Well, what the hell does me living with my mother have to do with anything?
I'm just saying, your mother called me and left me a lovely message. So I was saying, at least you were raised by what appears to be a wonderful woman. So I don't know how you got steered in the Republican way.
Oh, sorry.
Yes,
sorry.
It was a compliment to your mother, not to you.
Oh, sorry.
What's your point?
What I was trying to say, I was trying to get to the one thing that I was, before you cut me off, before I was trying to mention Trump's other mistake.
Building
the embassy in Jerusalem was a mistake.
Hey, Trump, the day he announced his candidacy and said, some people, there were Mexicans, you know, they're rapists and murderers, some I'm sure are good people.
Now you're doing what Pamela Geller does with the Quran. Now you're just doing what people like her and Brigitte Gabrielle do with the Quran. You're taking it out of context.
No, I'm not.
Because of the fact. Yes, you are. He didn't say that Mexicans were rapists. He said, when Mexico sends its people, it's not sending its debt.
Mexico doesn't send its people. That's what I said. You're 18 years old. Read a fucking newspaper and grow up. My God. I'm sorry. Laughing. We have more important things to do. Oh, my God.
All right. Let's go to Tweeties because you know I have a breath. Right?
Cleansing breath. Okay. Let loose the birdies.
Welcome to my tweets.
This is one of those days.
Oh my God. Okay, we shook that off. Okay.
Yes.
Okay, so here's how according to Paula Chertok, who is a lawyer, she said on Twitter, Trump announced his plan to cheat and steal election 2020. One, he declares victory on election day before all the votes by mail are counted. Two, federal courts stop states from counting past November 3rd, counting on the courts he has packed, including SCOTUS, to hand him a win like Bush in 2000. In other words, he's got the courts now, and
yeah,
they'll give him a decision.
This is what scares me.
Yeah, this is what scares me. This is exactly what you and I predicted back like 4 years, 5 years ago, whenever it was he announced. Okay. From the Daily Beast, the managing editor of Red State, that's a conservative website.
Oh, my
Red
God.
Red State,
yes,
obviously, is a conservative website.
Yes.
He writes under a pseudonym, and he's actually a press officer at the National Institute of Health.
Not anymore.
He has used his Red State perch to spread COVID disinformation and smear his boss, Dr. Fauci, as a mask Nazi. And under his pseudonym, Cruz, his real name is C-R-E-W-S, Mr. Cruz, has derided his own colleagues as part of a left-wing anti-Trump conspiracy and vehemently criticized the man who leads his agency, whom he described as the the attention-grabbing and media-whoring Anthony Fauci.
He has gone after
other public health officials at the state and federal levels as well, the public health Karen Waffen, as he calls them, over measures such as closures of businesses and other public establishments and the promotion of social distancing and mask wearing. We're talking about the PR official here, okay, at the NIH. He said, policies have no basis in science, are simply surreptitious efforts to usurp Americans' rights, destroy the U.S. economy, damage Trump's reelection effort. It's safe to say in the entire Wuhan virus scare, nothing more or less than a massive fraud. If there were justice, he said, we'd send and send a few dozen of these fascists to the gallows and gibbet their tarred bodies in chains until they fall apart. Cruz isn't just a civil servant anonymously disagreeing with bosses online. He's actively undermining their work, even suggesting retribution against them. Vast majority of his writing published during the work week, often during normal business hours, raising questions about ethical use of taxpayer money. His writings on Red State repeatedly allude to fascism, Nazism, with references to the public health Gestapo and masked Nazi Fauci, a government that can force you to wear purely symbolic face masks in prescribed manner,
okay,
can make you wear a yellow Mugen David and get on
a
the
yellow
box.
Mugen David instead of a yellow star of David. This guy is, oh my God. Okay, I had to cut you off because I couldn't listen to that shit anymore. This guy worked both jobs. He was managing editor of Red State while he was the PR flack for NIH.
Mm-hmm.
This is unbelievable. But only the best people. Donald Trump hires only the best people. Ugh. God.
Okay. On to something even less appealing.
Oh, no.
One America Network.
Oh,
so they're
God.
Showing Biden, and Oliver Willis got a screen grab, and he says, this is amazing. On One America, they blur out the signage on Joe Biden's podium. Not even Fox pulls that kind of thing. Amazing.
Right.
So you're looking at Biden,
right?
And on his podium is his, you know, text such
three,
and such, whatever.
Joe, 30330. Joe. Joe.
Joe, 30330.
Joe.
30330. Go to Joe.
Joe
30330.
Boom.
Anyway,
okay.
It's a big blur. So that was petty. Nice and petty and annoying.
Unbelievable. Thoroughly believable, but unbelievable. Yeah.
But here's some good news. Bloomberg fundraising paid the fine for 32,000 felons in Florida so they can still vote.
Oh, Mugen David means Star of David. I know Mugen David, which is the kosher wine that is really
nasty.
Oh, no,
Mugen David is the Star of David.
Oh, I didn't see. Shows what I know.
Thank God, these headlines that are coming in. Anyway, Bloomberg paid the fines for 32,000 felons in Florida.
Yeah,
so they
I saw
vote.
That, but the way it was worded was like he raised $14,000 to pay the fines.
Now it's 20, by the way.
Oh, now it's 20.
20
but
million.
But he also said that he was spending $100 million in Florida for Biden, right. And my immediate thought was pay off those fines and fees so these felons who paid their debt to society can vote as we, the voters of the state of Florida, demanded 2 years ago.
It says here, Bloomberg, who ran in the primary, has endorsed Biden and has donated at least $100 million to the campaign to defeat Trump. So I guess he's sort of branching out and doing
good. I hope he pays off all of those fines and fees, because he should, because it is a modern day poll tax, and governor death sentence here in Florida is doing everything he can to keep people from voting. Oh, and he put another law into let me share this with you while we're on the subject of death sentence. He pushed legislation that he described as bold yesterday under the new criminal offenses section established by the would-be Combating Violence Disorder and Looting and Law Enforcement Protection Act. How's that for a mouthful? Death sentence declared it a third-degree felony to obstruct traffic during a, quote, an unpermitted protest, demonstration, or violent or disorderly assembly. Notably, the next clause purports to move liability for injury or death a driver causes if that driver is, quote, fleeing for safety from a mob. So Governor Death Sentence here in Florida is trying to push through legislation that basically says if you're a driver, you can plow your car through a crowd of protesters. And right. if you kill somebody, that's fine.
And it's basically he's trying to make it against the law to protest.
Yes. And saying if you kill protesters with your car, so that the Heather Heyer's murderer right. in Charlottesville would have been acquitted. No big deal. They were not permitted. They were protesting illegally. Kill them. Yeah, just kill them.
No big deal.
What country is this?
It's the murder country.
Yeah.
Okay, David Wasserman, who works for the Cook Political Report. Oh, yep. God. He's the editor over there. He said, I'm kind of amazed more Dems haven't seized the opportunity to portray Trump as a Trojan horse for Mitch McConnell and DC's radical right. Although Democrats tend to think of Trump's wing of the party as the extreme one, scholarship has routinely shown, this is really surprising to me, independents and swing voters, one, actually view Trump as more moderate, and two, dislike establishment Republicans such as McConnell much more. By the way, these independent swing voters also disliked Romney more than Trump and view him as more extreme and far right than Trump. Linking Trump to Romney McConnell could actually pay off for Dems. Still not sure the Lincoln Project understands this dynamic.
Hmm. Yeah, Lincoln Project, again, I've got my issues with the Lincoln Project.
Oh, sure.
You know, they put out some great spots, but I did I saw a discussion about them that along the lines of what you were just talking about, Laffy, that says it their tactics could be backfiring. So.
Oh.
Yeah, because people are, you know, they're taking it the wrong way. They're siding with Trump against these attacks on him. It's like
Andrew Prokop, who is a legal person, what does he do? He writes for Vox. He's a senior politics correspondent,
right. Okay.
Not legal. He says, I think the reason for holding the vote before the election is pretty simple. McConnell just doesn't know what the world will look like after Election Day. Also, moving ahead now means that there's still time for a backup plan if the nomination should unexpectedly blow up.
Oy. Oh,
my Isn't that God. Reassuring? Yay.
No.
I know.
No, it's not.
I know. I'm trying to be funny. Okay, Ellie Mistal.
Okay. I love Ellie Mistal. Yeah.
I've got a bunch of tweets from him, but this particular one is a thread of three or four. I am really nonplussed by the extent liberals are going to try to come up with some solution other than court expansion. I don't think people understand that court expansion is, in caps, literally the easiest thing to do according to the Constitution. A court expansion is one freaking bill. You don't need an amendment.
Uh-huh.
You don't need to overturn 220 years of judicial interpretation. Mm-hmm. You don't need the Supreme Court to agree that your plan is constitutional. You can just do it. People can just vote on it and do it. And then somebody said, well, I think it's a bad idea because when Republicans are back in power, they can pack the court with more of their people. And he says, term limiting justices is arguably unconstitutional. Adding justices is clearly constitutional. And if Republicans want to add more later, fine. It's no worse than what they do now.
That's true.
That's, you get it? They're bad now. Do something. That's basically what he's saying. They're bad. They're going to keep being bad. And Democrats need to get off their asses and do something. Okay, another one from him. Why are people living in fear of Republicans adding more justices if they retake control of the Senate later when Republicans have already shown, and this is in all caps, that no Democrats are allowed to appoint Supreme Court justices when Republicans are in power? How is what comes later worse?
Very legitimate questions. Yep.
Yes.
Yep.
Yes. And here's one more from him. Mitt Romney likes all the policies Trump pushes. He just doesn't like how Trump sounds while doing it. This is true of every elected Republican, except for the dumb ones who like the way Trump sounds while doing it.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Well, okay.
Listen to your Uncle Ellie, everybody.
Yes.
He's very good. All right. Now, here's another thread that you and I talked about earlier.
Okay.
And this is from Mark Joseph Stern, and he's a staff writer for Slate.
Right.
And he says stuff. Here's what he says. If Senate, and this is a little bit long, but bear with me. If Senate Democrats do not threaten to expand the Supreme Court after Republicans install a justice in the middle of an election or during the lame duck, hello, nobody's talking about that.
Nope.
They will have effectively surrendered. There is no other proportional response. It's court expansion or nothing. Republicans established new rules. The party in power can use any tool at its disposal to seize the Supreme Court within explicit constitutional limits. Democrats will solve nothing if they unilaterally disarm. They can either adopt the new rules and expand the court or die. Democratic senators who won't support court expansion as a proportional response to this power grab should be treated as cowards and dupes of the right. Republicans have ruthlessly shattered all norms and principles to seize the judiciary. Democrats must respond in kind. Progressives should be inundating Democratic senators with calls, mm-hmm. which I have done, demanding to know their plan if Trump installs a new justice. Quote, first we try to stop him, unquote, isn't good enough. We need to know what Democrats intend to do when Plan A fails and Republicans seize the Supreme Court. It's failing, guys. Mm-hmm. RBG's death is the biggest crisis of Trump's entire presidency, but too many progressives are consumed by the election to grasp the magnitude of the catastrophe unfolding before our eyes. Republicans are poised to obliterate the progressive agenda for decades. This is the fight. Also, Republicans are hypocrites, end quote, is not a plan. Democratic senators don't need to tell us how unprincipled Republicans are. We know. Republicans don't care. Democrats need to talk about the material consequences of a far-right SCOTUS, like the imminent eradication of the ACA.
Yep.
Finally, he says, a far-right Supreme Court threatens everything Democrats support. The ACA, mm-hmm. Roe v. Wade, mm-hmm. marriage equality, one person, one vote, voting rights, gun safety laws, carbon regulations, affirmative action, unions, campaign finance laws, redistricting reform. It is all on the table.
Yep.
And I sent you an article. I don't know if you got it. I DM'd it to you.
Yeah.
And I saved it so I could tell you where it is. It's from justsecurity.org. Oh, okay.
Yep.
And it's called Senate Procedures Offer No Hope for Dems on Supreme Court.
Yeah, well, before
nominee.
You get to that, let me share this. So I found this from David Sirota yesterday.
Yeah.
What he wrote in his newsletter, TMI, it's true that if Republicans hold together, they can vote a Supreme Court nominee through with a simple majority. That is, if they're able to force a vote. And it's not a given they'll be able to if Democrats use all of their power. And then he writes, the Senate runs on the unanimous consent system, which basically means that to do its most basic business, all senators must consent. And they do. It's just passed by a unanimous consent. In this situation, he writes, Senate Democrats have the power to use that system to grind everything to a halt. They can refuse to grant unanimous consent for the smallest things. They can force the reading of entire bills out loud. They can hold up the federal budget that the government needs to run. They can use these tactics to try to push back any confirmation hearings on a potential nominee. And they can try to do these things at least until after the next president is installed, all while they remind the public of the hypocrisy of Republican senators who said they would not try to install a judge during an election year. So that's what David Sirota wrote, but you said this piece at justsecurity.org says, not really.
Says not so much.
Yeah.
And I it's too long to read. I mean, I'll try to find that one part. Senate procedures. Here we go.
Yeah.
Conservative flauntis bona fides. Well, it's one of those things where I could do a search.
Right. I'm looking through it too. It's long. It's not saying that they can't, force a reading of every bill out loud.
Right.
It's not saying they can't, refuse to participate in unanimous consent and make them hold a vote on every tiny motion. This will all eat up time. So this doesn't address that. I think it's basically saying there's no legislative fix. There's no way around this because it's majority rule. Thank you, Harry Reid, who killed the filibuster for appointments. And then Mitch McConnell killed it for Supreme Court appointments.
Right. Then our friend that we discussed, she said, here's the tools. She said, the tools that we have is like using a spoon to dig an escape tunnel.
Right.
They have refusal to give unanimous consent to proceed, forcing all proceedings to be read into the record. Like you said, gums up the works, but I would think McConnell would do something devious, like meet at 3 a.m. having only Republicans to show up and eliminating unanimous consent. Oh, my goodness.
Oh, that's you. You're getting an Amber alert on your phone, I believe.
Yes, I am. No, yes,
that's
I am.
That's what it sounds like.
Stop.
Wow.
Stop.
Wow.
Well, okay.
Okay. Wow. That woke me up.
Sorry. That was loud.
Right. But there's a lot of schools of thought on this. So we were talking last night. Lawrence O'Donnell did a segment on it. We're running out of time. So let me play this. Because Lawrence O'Donnell, this is what he said.
There's only one way to block this nomination, to stall it, to slow down the United States Senate. There is only one way for Democrats to seize control of the calendar of the United States Senate and throw up a roadblock to this nomination in the Senate. And this parliamentary maneuver is not something that the Democratic leader of the Senate, Chuck Schumer, can do.
Oh,
it's not something any Democratic senator can do. There is literally nothing Democratic senators can do to block this nomination. But the House of Representatives can do something.
Ooh.
The Democratic House of Representatives can actually seize control of the calendar in the United States Senate. Speaker Nancy Pelosi can do that, and she knows that she can do that, and she was very, very careful when she was asked about it yesterday by George Stephanopoulos, who, before he worked in the Clinton White House, was on the staff of the Democratic leadership in the House of Representatives.
Mm.
Some have mentioned the possibility, if they try to push through a nominee in a lame duck session, that you and the House could move to impeach President Trump or Attorney General Barr as a way of stalling and preventing the Senate from acting on this nomination.
Well, we have our options. We have arrows in our quiver that I'm not about to discuss right now.
If Nancy Pelosi delivers articles of impeachment to the United States Senate, Senate rules say, upon such articles being presented to the Senate shall, at 1 o'clock afternoon of the day, Sunday accepted, following such presentation, or sooner if ordered by the Senate, proceed to the consideration of such articles and shall continue in session from day to day, Sundays accepted, after the trial shall commence, unless otherwise ordered by the Senate, until final judgment shall be rendered, and so much longer as may, in its judgment, be needful. Today, on the Senate floor, Chuck Schumer said, there is only one way. Those were his exact words. There is only one way. He didn't say he had arrows in his quiver, just one arrow. And it's not in his quiver.
Ooh.
There's only one way for this chamber to retain its dignity through this difficult chapter. There's only one way for us to have some hope of coming together again, trusting each other again, lowering the temperature, moving forward. And that is for four brave Senate Republicans to commit to rejecting any nominee until the next president is
installed. Not going to happen.
Not going to happen. Laffy, boy, you threw your voice there beautifully.
That was weird. Yeah, so it's not going to happen.
That's not going to happen. So I guess it's up to Nancy Pelosi again.
Well, they can impeach Barr.
They can impeach Barr, but that also comes from the House. So it's up to Nancy Pelosi.
But I mean, if they're head shy about trying to impeach
I hear you. Yeah. And Barr, if anybody deserves to be impeached, it's certainly Bill Barr.
Oh, yeah.
And John Goodman needs to play him in the movie.
Yes. Oh, perfect.
Definitely. Although he needs to gain back some of the weight he lost.
I know. He got so thin.
He did. He got too thin.
And so, it looks kind of like, he looks like something's missing. He's almost not gone.
Half a person.
You know what I mean? Like deflated almost. Yeah. It's a strange kind of thing.
I know.
But at least it's healthy.
Yeah. So here we are.
Yeah. Well, I'm thoroughly depressed, and I wake up every morning literally crying. I mean, not just, but sobbing, because it hits me every time I open my eyes in the morning.
I don't know how things can get a whole lot worse, but have no fear.
Oh, because, he will.
Oh, yeah.
But I, my biggest fear is that he'll get the courts to just rule in his favor, and he'll be in office for another 4 years, and then after that, maybe even longer.
Yeah. I wish they didn't stop making Quaaludes all those years ago. Sorry.
I wish I was into them.
Way to pass the time, because I don't know. All right. On that note, sorry to leave you like this. I have no idea what we're doing tomorrow. We'll find out. I take it one day at a time these days, because that's all we got.
1 hour at a time.
Gotta Laugh. Find her on the Twitters and here on Tuesday, and I'll see you tomorrow. Thanks, everyone.
Bye.
Bye.